Morning. We're glad that you were able to join us today, right where you are. We know some are listening to this on their phones as they drive, or we know that some are watching in their living rooms, but we want you to know that our desire for you right now is that you can put all distractions aside and worship our Savior. We have a few announcements this morning. We want you to know that we desire to stay connected with you as well. So there's a spot on our website that you can go and fill out a connection card. There's a prayer email that you can send us your prayer requests, and anybody on staff will get in touch with you and will be glad to pray with you and follow up with you throughout those prayer requests. And also, there's a couple different ways to give. You can give online. You can give your tithe through the app. Or there's a telephone number as well that you can text your tithe to. But we desire for all of us right now to just put the distractions aside and join us as we worship. Let's pray. God, we come to you this morning. And Lord, we know that worshiping in our homes is not that what you called us to do, but during this time, that's what we are blessed to be able to do. And we thank you for that. We thank you for the time that we're able to spend with family around us. Lord, we thank you for the time that we're able to worship you in a different way. Because, Lord, maybe getting out of our comfort zone is what you really wanted us to do at this point. And, Lord, finding time to get on our knees and just reach out to you and say, God, here I am. Allow me to worship you differently than I ever have. Lord, I pray today as we worship all across Tuscaloosa, all across Northport, all across the world when people watch this, Lord, that, Lord, that you're glorified. It's not about anybody that's on this stage behind me. Lord, it's all about you. And, Lord, we pray that you'll be honored and glorified in all that we say and do. In your Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're excited to bring you a choir song this morning from a couple weeks ago. We hope that you enjoy this time as the choir leads us in worship.
Emmanuel's veins. A sinner was plunged beneath the flood and God saved. Since then I walk in forgiveness. All of my guilt was erased. The chains of the past broken at last, I got saved. Oh, I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How could I want more? I've received nothing but goodness. I've tested and tasted your grace. I was so lost till I fell at the cross and got saved. Oh, I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How could I want more? The love of God gave me his pardon. The love of God won't let me stay the same. The love of God pulls me up higher, much stronger. That's why I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How could I want more? I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How could I want more? Of Jesus, I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How could I want more? I've got Jesus. How could I want more? I've got Jesus. How could I?
Well, good morning. We're glad that you have tuned in to worship with us this morning, and we're excited, as always, that we get to worship our Savior this morning. We hope that you'll, right where you are, just sing along with us this morning, and we're going to open today with a song called Only King Forever. Let's worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords together today.
Solid ground, nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King. Victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Unmatched in all your wisdom.
All your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
Oh,
we trust in the name of Jesus. you I am. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Oh. Amen. We worship together this morning the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He is the King. He is eternal. He is immortal. We praise Him together this morning, and we just want to continue to lift up the name of Jesus. As we sing where we are today, wherever you are, whether it's at home, maybe you're sitting on your back porch watching on your computer, whatever it is this morning, there's one reason that we all worship together, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. So this morning, as we continue our worship, He is the reason we live. He is the reason we sing. Would you pray? Would you sing with us this morning?
There's a reason I can sing. There's a reason for this life inside me. One name above all names, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus. There's a reason for this home. There's a reason for this peace that I know. One worthy of all praise, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus. I will lift my hands up. I will raise my voice up. I will shout of your love. Goodness of your grace each day, I will bow and bless your name, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I will lift my hands up, I will raise my voice up, I will shout of your love till the day that I die. I will lift my hands up.
Amen, amen. I can't think of a better reason to sing this morning than for all that God has done for me and for my family. And church, I hope you feel the same. I hope you have that same desire to lift praises to Him. I want to read a passage for you this morning from Revelation chapter 4. It's going to be a little lengthy, so y'all can sit down if you're not already. But I want you to listen to what John says here in Revelation 4, starting in verse 1. It says, "After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, 'Come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this.' Immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius stone in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne, in appearance like an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes. And they had crowns of gold on their heads. And from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices. 7 lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. Before the throne there was a sea of glass like crystal, and in the midst of the throne and around the throne were 4 living creatures full of eyes in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion, the second living creature like a calf, the third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. The 4 living creatures, each having 6 wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night, saying, 'Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.' Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to Him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before Him who sits on the throne and worship Him who lives forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, 'You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for You have created all things, and by Your will they exist and were created.'" Church, John had the opportunity to go to the throne room. He had an opportunity to go and see something that no man had ever seen or has seen on this side of glory. He witnessed something that obviously for many of us it would be hard to describe. But he witnessed something so incredible as he watched all these different creatures worship the one true God. This morning, wherever you are, or whenever it is that you watch this video, I pray that you get to encounter that type of worship today, that you get to experience that throne room. I know God's presence is wherever you are, just as He is in this place. And we're grateful for that presence today. And so I pray that you would worship just as all of these beings did, singing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Worship with us as we lift up those exact same words this morning.
This morning, worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, 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 is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is.
Father, we love you today, and we thank you so much for the time of worship that we've been able to have this morning, where we can just sing praise to your name. And as Josh just said, we thank you for that scripture, from that word that you've given us this morning, where we can come and we can sing, holy, 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 the God who was, the God who is, the God who is to come. God, we worship you today. We praise you, and we praise your name, and we lift you on high. And Lord, we look forward to hearing from your word this morning, the message that you have given Brother John, and we look forward to hearing what you have to say to us through your word this morning. God, I pray that you would use it to change us, that you would use it to touch us this morning and to speak to our hearts and to draw us closer to you. And God, I pray that every day that we'll be better equipped and we'll be ready to serve you with the life you've given us. And God, we just pray that you give us an opportunity to do that every day. We give you praise, we give you honor, we give you glory, for you are worthy. And we pray these things in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, church. If you would take your Bibles in your homes, and I hope that you have your Bible along with you, and turn with me, if you will, as we continue to worship the Lord this morning through His Word. And I'm going to be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 12 and following. So if you have your Bibles, turn there with me to 1 Corinthians 15, verse 12 and following, in which the Apostle Paul writes, "Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, even as we have read this portion of your word, we know that Jesus is risen. And our hope and our faith rests in the fact that he died, was buried, and was raised from the dead on the third day. And I pray that even as we have read this portion of your word, that you would bless its reading, and the words of my own mouth would be found acceptable in your holy sight. My rock and my redeemer, I pray, in Jesus' blessed name, amen. Now, as you know, last Sunday was Easter Sunday. And due to the coronavirus pandemic, we had an Easter like we had never known before and hopefully will never know again. Because you see, all of the Easter celebrations in churches clear across this nation of ours and the world, of course, they were canceled. But you know, even though the Easter celebrations across this nation and our world and our churches were canceled, let me assure you the fact that Easter was not canceled. And you see, the only way that the devil could ever cancel Easter would have been to keep Jesus from rising from the dead. But we know that didn't happen. For you see, up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with the saints to reign. Hallelujah, Christ arose. But let me ask you a question. Suppose that never had happened. Suppose there had been no resurrection from the dead. Suppose that Jesus was still in the grave. Well, let me just say that if there had been no resurrection, if Jesus Christ was still in the grave, the Apostle Paul, in these verses that we have read this morning, mentioned six things, six tragic things that would have happened had Jesus not been raised from the dead. Six tragic things that would have happened if there had been no Easter. And notice what those things are. First of all, the Apostle Paul said that if Jesus Christ had not been raised from the dead, that if there had been no Easter, he tells us in verse 14 that our preaching is in vain. That is to say that if Christ had not been raised from the dead, that our preaching is empty. You see, if you could show me that Christ had not been raised from the dead, or if you could show me that he was still in the grave, I'm telling you, I would close this book and I would never preach again. Because you see, if Jesus was still in the grave, if there had been no Easter, then we have nothing to preach. You see, if Jesus had not been raised from the dead, then our preaching would be meaningless. If Christ had not been raised from the dead, my friend, you shouldn't waste your time listening to me this morning, and you should find something else to do. Because you see, if Christ had not been raised from the dead, our preaching is empty. Our preaching has no meaning whatsoever if Christ had not been raised from the dead. But secondly, not only that, but Paul says that if Christ had not been raised from the dead, if there had been no Easter, not only does he tell us in verse 14 that our preaching would be in vain, but if Christ had not been raised from the dead, if there had been no Easter, he says, your faith would be empty, that your faith would be in vain. You see, if Jesus had not been raised from the dead, then my friend, you have put your trust in something that doesn't deserve your trust. Now, how do I know that the Bible is true? How do I know that Jesus was raised from the dead? How do I know that Jesus is the Son of God? How do I know that Jesus can save? How do I know that everything the Bible says about Jesus is true? I'll tell you how I know. You see, Jesus was raised from the dead on the third day. And his resurrection from the dead was God's stamp of approval on everything that he ever said or did. But yet, if Jesus had not been raised from the dead, Paul says that our preaching is empty. If Christ had not been raised from the dead, then your faith is empty, your faith is in vain. But not only that, but he goes on to say in these verses that if Christ had not been raised from the dead, then Paul, along with the others who were witnesses of the resurrection, were false witnesses. That if Christ had not been raised from the dead, that they are false witnesses. Now, do you know what a false witness is? That's someone who would go into a courtroom and who would sit upon the witness chair and knowingly and willingly and deliberately lie as a witness. And you see, that's what the Apostle Paul is saying. That if Christ has not been raised from the dead, then we are not reliable witnesses. That if Christ has not been raised from the dead, that we are false witnesses. And you say, well, how do you know that they didn't make up this whole story? Well, that's a good question. But you see, the reason I know that they didn't make up a false story, that they were not false witnesses, because most of those whom Paul mentions here in these verses in chapter 15, who had actually witnessed Jesus after he had been raised from the dead, they paid for it by giving up their own lives as martyrs. You know, I find it interesting that when Jesus suffered and bled and died upon the cross, he was exposed to the eyes of unbelievers. But when he was raised from the dead on the third day, he was seen only by believers. And you see, those believers went on to be the very witnesses of the resurrection. You know, I also find it interesting that after Jesus had been raised from the dead and when he ascended back into heaven, as he ordered his disciples to go back into Jerusalem, into that upper room, and to wait upon the gift and the power, the Holy Spirit, to come, up in that upper room, you'll remember that we read in the book of Acts that Peter stood up among the disciples and he said that we must choose someone to take Judas's place, who had betrayed the Lord to become one of the 12 apostles of the church. And we read that one of the requirements for one of the disciples to take Judas's place and to be an apostle was the fact that that person had to have seen Jesus raised from the dead. And so the Apostle Paul is making it clear that we've all seen Jesus raised from the dead. And my friend, if Jesus is in that grave, Paul says that makes us false witnesses. That makes them liars. That makes them cheats. That makes them frauds. Are you going to tell me that Peter was a scoundrel? Are you going to tell me that the Apostle John was a liar? Are you going to tell me that the Apostle Paul, when he was still Saul and was struck down on that road to Damascus, and as he looked up into heaven, he saw the glorified and risen Lord? Are you going to tell me that he was a colossal fraud? You say, I'm not saying that. But my friend, that's the conclusion you come to if you believe that Jesus is still in that grave. If he is still in the grave, Paul says, then we are nothing more than just false witnesses. And let me tell you, my friend, I know that there may be a few people who might live for a lie, but I don't know of anybody who would die for a lie. And most of the people who had witnessed the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ had seen him alive that are mentioned here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Were people who paid for their testimony and sealed their testimony by the giving of their own blood. But they weren't afraid of death. Why? Because they had seen Jesus alive after he had died upon the cross. And since he was raised from the dead and they saw him raised from the dead and they witnessed his resurrection, they no longer had fear of death in any way because they knew that death has been swallowed up in victory. But as Paul said, if Jesus had not been raised from the dead, our preaching is in vain. Our faith is in vain. The disciples were false witnesses. But something else he says, if Christ had not been raised from the dead, had there been no Easter, then folks, we would still be in our sin. Because he goes on to say that if Christ is not risen, then you are still in your sins. Why did Jesus suffer and bleed and die upon the cross? He died upon the cross for our sins, to pay a penalty that he did not owe, to save us from a penalty that we could never pay. And if Jesus died for our sins and is still in the grave, then that means that his death upon the cross is not sufficient to pay for the penalty of our sin, and that we are still in our sins. And what a terrible thing to think that we could still be in our sins. And what a terrible thing to think that we could die in our sins. And Jesus, the one who died for our sins and was raised from the dead, is the very one who said that the worst thing that could ever happen to anybody is to die in their sins. But if Jesus was still in the grave, then we are still in our sins. And what a terrible state to be in. And Paul says, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, that if there had been no Easter, he's saying that our preaching is in vain. He is saying that your faith is in vain. He is saying that all of the witnesses that are recorded in chapter 15 were false witnesses. If Christ had not been raised from the dead, he said we are still in our sins. But then the next thing that he says, that if Christ had not been raised from the dead, had there been no Easter, then he says that death has not been defeated. For he says in verse 18, then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If Jesus has not been raised from the dead, when we die in our sins, we perish. Now let me tell you, that word perish does not mean a cessation of life. It does not mean the ending of life. It means simply this: there's no longer a quality of our being. Our being does not cease with death, because you see, the soul can never die. And if Jesus is still in the grave, it doesn't mean that we know that our being no longer lives. It just simply means that we no longer have well-being, because one day we will have to stand and give an account before God for all of our sin. And I shudder to think what it would be like to have to give an account of my sin before God, and knowing that death is not only physical, but death becomes eternal, and there will be separation from God in hell forevermore. What a tragic thing if Christ has not been raised from the dead. But then there's one other thing that Paul mentions in these verses, that if there had been no resurrection, if there had been no Easter, he then simply makes it clear that the future is futile. That the future is futile. Because notice what he says at the end of verse, there in verse 19. He says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. You see, the future is futile. We're all men we're all miserable, pitiful, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, because there's no future to look for. You see, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, the only thing that we can look forward to is a 6-foot hole and nothing more, if Christ had not been raised from the dead. You know, we would have no hope whatsoever. It's like what Ernest Hemingway said. And Ernest Hemingway, my friend, was not a believer. And when he came to the time when about before he took his life and he had no hope whatsoever, this is how he summarized life. He said that we are all like a colony of ants living on one end of a burning log. We're all nothing more than a colony of ants living on one end of a burning log. Now, that'll give you something to hope for when you wake up in the morning. Of course not. But you see, that's how hopeless, that's how pitiful we would be if Christ had not been raised from the dead, if there had been no Easter.
But let me tell you this, my friend. The reason I'm preaching this morning and the reason you are listening is because we know that Christ has been raised from the dead. And you see, for that reason, because there has been Easter, because Christ has been raised from the dead, that's why our preaching is profitable. And that's why your faith is feasible. And that's why the witness of the disciples, their witness, that's dependable. And that's why we know that our sins have been forgiven. And that's why we know that death has been defeated. And that's why we have hope for tomorrow. Because listen to what he says in verse 20. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. You know, that says that because Jesus has been raised from the dead, my friend, one day we ourselves are going to be raised from the dead. And for that reason, because he has been raised from the dead, he has taken the gloom out of the grave. He has taken the dread out of death, because we know that one day we ourselves will be raised from the dead when we've placed our faith and our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. And one day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Aren't we so thankful? Aren't we thankful for what we have to look for? Because Jesus has been raised from the dead. Now, if you're listening to me this morning and you've never received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, all of that's for naught in your life unless you receive him as your Lord and Savior. Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door of your heart and knock. And if any person hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into their life." And my friend, if the Holy Spirit of God is speaking to your heart and drawing you to Christ, and you've never received him into your heart as your personal Lord and Savior, as I pray this prayer out loud, you pray it silently. Repeat these words after me and say them to God and mean it with all of your heart. Would you pray with me? Dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I deserve to die, but I know you love me enough to die for me. And I believe you were raised from the dead for me. And as best as I know how, I ask you to come into my heart, forgive me, save me, and from this day forward, please transform me into the person you would have me to be. Thank you for forgiving me, and thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now, if you're listening to me and you prayed that prayer, you'll notice there's a number you can call. And that's the Chapel Hill Baptist Church number. And there will be ministers there that will receive your call and that would love to pray with you and encourage you and help you along life's way now that you have made the most important decision of your life in receiving Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And if you would like for us to pray with you, to encourage you in any way we can, you call that number and we'll certainly be in touch. Thank you for hearing me this morning, and I look forward and I hope very soon when we'll be able to gather together as a congregation, family of believers at Chapel Hill Baptist Church to worship the Lord together on Sunday morning, and hopefully it won't be long now, maybe just another week or two, but we look forward to that glorious day when we're gathered together as a church to worship the living Lord. Thank you so much.